In the summer of 1962, Dr. Geza de Kaplani courted beautiful Hoina Pilla through her mother. For the doctor was a Hungarian with old-fashioned aristocratic manners. Widowed Mrs. Pilla, another Hungarian, was an absolutely fearful snob. She accepted the doctor's proposal of marriage to her daughter with avidity. A compatriot with vaguely aristocratic lineage, a well-paid anesthesiologist, he was everything she wanted for Hoina. The couple were married early in August. Neither Hoina nor her mother seemed to have included in their calculations the fact that the doctor was the most irredeemably odious man in the not very prepossessing upper-class Hungarian émigré community of San Jose, California. Dr. de Kaplani was one of three sons of a supposed baron. Brought up on the family estate in a remote part of Hungary, the boy was almost untouched by the war. The worst suffering of his childhood was caused by his father's autocratic severity. He was blinded in one eye as a result of paternal chastisement and wore rose-tinted rimless spectacles in adult life to conceal the defect. But this suffering ended after his father's death, when the boy was 12. Somehow the family ingratiated themselves with the post-war communist regime, and Geza acquired training as a doctor. But he fled the country after Imre Nagy's ill-fated uprising of 1956 and came to America. He wrote a book of memoirs describing his adventures and escape, which other Hungarians perceived as totally phony. Indeed, they calculated from the time of Dr. Kaplani's flight that he was among the notorious communist sympathizers and secret police informants who took to their heels when the brief flowering of democracy allowed mobs to lynch the worst persecutors of the Stalinist regime. But naturally, Dr. de Kaplani didn't allow any such blemish on his credentials to be known in McCarthyite America. He was astoundingly arrogant and self-important. He was outraged that his Central European qualifications were not instantly acknowledged in the USA, and like any other immigrant doctor, he had to sit state examinations before being allowed to practice. He was distinctly ungrateful when he was permitted to study for the anesthesiology exams in Boston. The doctor saw himself as a cardiac specialist and despised anesthetics as too humble a branch of the profession for a man of his talents. In Boston, in 1959, he embarked on an American love life that was to be extensive and consistently revolting. He seduced a Swedish bank clerk named Ruth Kreuger. She quickly became pregnant, and the doctor took decisive steps to rid himself of the embarrassment. He told Ruth he could not marry her, as he had a wife who was tragically incarcerated in an insane asylum and could not be divorced. It was a barefaced lie. He told Ruth he would provide for her and her unborn child through a valuable insurance policy, which he took out, naming her as beneficiary. He encouraged Ruth to go back to Sweden to have her baby, and as soon as she was out of the way, he altered the policy to name his mother and an aircraft engineer friend in Seattle as beneficiaries. His real and explicit reason for not marrying Ruth, though he did not tell her this, was that she was too plain for the doctor's refined aesthetic taste. The loathsome humbug wanted formal moral approval for his wickedness, however, and he consulted a Catholic priest in Boston. The good father proved that either he, or less probably his church's policy, let's not dignify it with the name of doctrine or teaching, could under duress prove only less immoral than the doctor. He solemnly assured the penitent that it would be quite wrong for him to make an honest woman of Ruth Kreuger, as she was a Protestant. And Ruth out of sight became Ruth out of mind. She was far, far luckier to be shot of Geza than she could ever have imagined. Once properly qualified as an American medical practitioner, Dr. Kaplani accepted the appointment as anesthesiologist at San Jose Hospital. The West Coast was a fine and hospitable setting, where he easily found a comfortable flat. The doctor's income was handsome. He had $5,000 deposited in a savings account, whose mysterious origins the penniless refugee never explained. He could set about one of his life's preferred activities, pursuing women. He enjoyed good looks as well as prosperity and status. In a thin-lipped, rather cruel way, the slender, well-dressed, dark and wavy-haired doctor was handsome. And many women find a physical suggestion of tautly controlled ruthlessness a turn-on. At the time when he started paying court to Hoyena through her mother, the doctor was actively pursuing, or more or less terminating, no less than 5 other relationships. The most important to him was with a Protestant Irish divorcee called Yvonne Sinagoglu. She was extremely beautiful, and the doctor repeatedly proposed to her, in person too, and not through any relatives. She equally repeatedly refused him. Not because she detected his detestable qualities, but for the genuine cause the doctor had so hypocritically espoused when his ghostly father in Boston put it to him. She would not marry a Catholic. The affair began in November 1961 and came to an end in June 1962. While avidly courting both Yvonne Sinagoglu and Hoyena Pillar, the doctor proposed to yet a third woman, and was accepted. Beautiful Margareta Herbst was a nurse at the hospital, and marriages between attractive nurses and handsome doctors are a familiar part of soap opera folklore. Yet the course of this true love was not running especially smooth. Margareta had no idea there were other women in the doctor's life. She was, however, acutely aware that his attentions to her varied and wavered. He blew hot and cold to the extent that she started accepting dates with other men. But it was still a complete surprise to her when, 2 days before his wedding, the doctor told her he was about to marry Hoyena. Happy Margareta, who had kept other, and let us hope, less frayed strings for her bow. Clara Gabriel was another beautiful nurse at the hospital. She accepted dates with the doctor, but never considered him as a marital prospect. With cynical honesty, he assured her that if they did marry, he would certainly go on sleeping with other women. So she accepted him as a merely casual beau. Geraldine Smith was less lucky. The 21-year-old hospital clerk went to plays and concerts with the doctor and accepted dinner invitations. She also accepted his invitation to accompany him on a skiing trip in April 1962. Perhaps she was naive, but she thought skiing meant skiing. When they reached Yosemite and she discovered that he had booked them into a double cabin and expected to sleep with her, she was shocked and refused, as was obviously her right. The disappointed fornicator immediately packed his bags and walked out on her, leaving the poor girl stranded without the ready money to continue the holiday on her own or make her way straight home. You may feel that Dr. Geza Kaplani was a heel of considerable distinction. Hoyena Pillar, the name is spelt Hajna, and is presumably the Hungarian form of Hannah, came to America as a teenager under circumstances that made international headlines. During the Melbourne Olympics of 1952, the entire Hungarian fencing team defected en masse to the West. Hoyena's father was the team coach. Life in Southern California suited Hoyena, who had the tall blonde beauty and creamily tanned complexion that is such an adornment to the Pacific beaches. She had been a beauty queen and was a model, often displaying distinctly revealing and sexy clothes when Dr. Kaplani's whirlwind courtship commenced. Her acceptance of the doctor, assuming her mother allowed her any say in the matter, seems to have been quite loveless. She already had a lover, another Hungarian who was an engineer. But he was married, and Hoyena slipped quite easily into the apparently fickle commitments of this strange émigré circle, accepting the doctor's money and status without any intention of giving up her main squeeze. I don't think the doctor deserved any better. They made a lovely couple at the wedding. It might have been assumed that their life would always be one of glamorous, civilized surfaces and coldly self-interested interiors. But less than 3 weeks after marrying, De Kaplani went to San Francisco and stayed overnight with Mrs. Jane Haidu. This 40-year-old woman, 4 years older than the svelte doctor, proceeded to make trouble in a big way. She said she felt a deeply maternal concern for Geza. You may think she was one of the women who fancied the little creep. She certainly behaved as though she were consumed with jealousy of the lovely Heiner. Mrs. Haidu told the doctor about Heiner's engineer lover. The news apparently came as a shock to him, and the following day he let Mrs. Haidu take him to see Berkeley attorney Scott Anderson. The newlywed doctor wanted a divorce. He wanted it on grounds of adultery, and he didn't want to pay a penny piece of alimony. The lawyer told him it couldn't be done. Not right away. He would have to go on living quietly with Heiner, while more evidence of adultery than Mrs. Hoidu's word was collected. On the other hand, he could start divorce proceedings immediately on grounds of mental cruelty, and he would be assured of unpublicized proceedings and the certainty of being granted his freedom. The doctor loftily refused. This was typical of America's inferior and unacceptable approach to matrimonial affairs. Heiner would escape without being severely criticized, and he might still have to pay alimony. The doctor returned to San Jose immediately, with his own plans boiling in his head. The following day, the 29th of August, hospital workers were a little surprised to see Dr. De Kaplani bustling around the place, clad only in Bermuda shorts, sandals, and a rubber apron. True, Southern California tolerated a relaxed informality of dress, but snooty Dr. Geza De Kaplani did not normally lower his sartorial standards so far. At 7 p.m., the doctor was back at home. He started playing classical music very loudly on his hi-fi and went to various neighbors apologizing for any disturbance. As another resident in the block of flats was playing pops almost equally loudly, the cacophony was unpleasant. But most of those to whom the doctor spoke were quietly impressed by his courtesy. They also reported that he wore only Bermuda shorts and sandals. At 7:20, Heiner was seen, alive and well, moving around in the flat. After that, she and the doctor made love. Their congress was not a success. It is suggested that the doctor found himself impotent. Suggested, too, that she taunted her husband with his failure, comparing him unfavorably with her engineer lover. The blaring music continued unabated, and at 9 p.m., a couple enjoying the last of the evening sun on the patio outside the block of flats became aware that there was an additional sound of constant running water from the De Kaplani residence. At 10 p.m., a curious undertone of moaning rose to terrible wailing that pierced the sound of music and water. It continued unabated, attracting a small gathering of anxious listeners on the patio, until at 10:18 the police drove up. The doctor himself had telephoned the emergency services. He greeted the constables with a self-satisfied smirk. He was still wearing his shorts and sandals and was sweating profusely. At 10:45, the neighborhood saw him led away under arrest, now smartly clad in a suit, collar and tie. The police had found a horrific spectacle. Heiner was tied naked to her bedpost, spread-eagled across the bed. Her face, breasts and genitals were hideously mutilated. After their unsuccessful coupling, the doctor had tied her down and warned her to make no sound if she hoped to survive. Then, donning rubber gloves and his rubber apron, he had taken a scalpel and made small cuts on her face and body. He had a quantity of bottles of acid, nitric, hydrochloric, and sulfuric in the bedroom, and this he daubed into the incisions with swabs. Hoina was slowly and inexorably tortured and defaced. Her moans rose to the piteous keening the neighbours heard. By the time the police arrived, the acid's corrosion had left nothing but frightful raw wounds and skinless flesh exuding water where there had once been beautiful features, a lovely bosom, enticing private parts. The wretched woman survived for 2 weeks in hospital before succumbing, a horribly scarred, grotesque parody of a human creature. There were fireworks at the doctor's trial the following year. His lawyers wanted to plead him not guilty by reason of insanity, and well they might, given what he had done and expected the police to accept as his prerogative when he telephoned them. But the doctor refused this proposal out of hand. He was certainly not insane, he insisted. He knew perfectly well what he was doing, and he was entirely justified in doing it. He was deliberately effacing Hoina's beauty so that no other men might ever be tempted and humiliated by it as he had been. He was a difficult client, arrogantly trying to interfere with the proceedings of the trial from the defence table. He was particularly adamant that the prosecution should not be allowed to show the jury photographs of Hoina's mutilated body. When he was overruled and the photographs were produced, the doctor staged an amazing scene. He stormed across the courtroom, seized the offending pictures, and changed his plea after looking at them. "I am a doctor," he screamed, "and if I have done this, then I must be mad." So a new line of defence emerged. Dr. Getzer de Kaplani now claimed to suffer from a split personality. His alter ego was a big, tough Frenchman called Pierre Laroche. It seemed that he'd always secretly wanted to be a macho Frenchman. It was suggested that this reflected a suppressed homosexual element in his personality. It was impossible to find a doctor who could confirm the split personality convincingly. The best medical support the doctor received came from a Dr. Beaton, who said he suffered from paranoid schizophrenia, delusions of grandeur coupled with a persecution complex, as a result of his father's severities. But two chiropodists appeared, who both confirmed that the doctor had made appointments with them under the name of Pierre Laroche. Why, neither they nor anyone else could explain. But I suspect that Dr. Getzer de Kaplani thought that having his corns cut was so infra-dig that he adopted an alias for the purpose. He was lucky that the jury was impressed by Dr. Beaton's evidence. They thought the doctor guilty of murder, of course, but given his possible mental state, they recommended life imprisonment rather than the gas chamber. Many Californians were disgusted. Getzer de Kaplani was obviously one of the most horrible murderers their state had ever seen, and if he wasn't fit to die, who was? There was a lobby ready to demand his continued incarceration for the full term of his natural life when he first became eligible to apply for parole in 1973. They were deeply shocked to discover that he'd been secretly released and smuggled out of the country 6 months earlier before they could present their case. The parole board lamely explained that he was a special prisoner whose cardiac skills were urgently needed in Taiwan, and so he'd been flown out there at the behest of the Taiwanese government. It was a major scandal, and the chairman of the board swiftly resigned for personal reasons. And the loathsome Dr. de Kaplani has been practicing his skills on the innocent, unsuspecting Taiwanese ever since.